Hard questions from the front, I assume.
So good morning, everybody. We're going to talk about our favorite topic, ad fraud in the advertising ecosystem. I've got Maureen Little here, who is the SVP of Business Development from Turn. I'm Dan Mosher. I run the exchange, the BrightRoll exchange for Yahoo. So I think we're going to start today. This topic is very near and dear to our hearts because we live it, breathe it every day. We've been working together, BrightRoll and Yahoo and Turn have been working together since 2006 in the display space and 2011 in the video space. So love to just hear, Maureen, what do you see are good practices in your exchange relationships? We represent the exchange, you represent the DSP. Talk a little bit about that approach and what you see as best practices from exchange side.
That's a good question. Good morning, everybody. How you doing? Hey. It's fraud talk, people. So first of all, when we first started buying on exchanges, there weren't all of the wonderful technology companies that are out here. In fact, those people at Turn who remember the days, we had a staff of people who had to read through and manually tag and do block lists. So we've seen it really, really evolve. And when I think of best practices on the exchange side, we have them pretty standard, they're public. We have inventory quality guidelines that we expect every exchange to uphold. So that means that they have a third-party technology that is monitoring both for site fraud and bot fraud, that we have an expectation of them alerting us when they have an issue. We have an expectation that they're monitoring all of the publishers before they're accepted. And let's be honest, that doesn't always happen. I think that there is a bit of a conflict in, if you're an exchange, you want to grow the impressions and drive a ton of yield for that publisher. And sometimes things, you know, they'll allow them to sneak through, and that's just simply not allowed. Turn has kind of a no tolerance. We pause exchanges if we see issues that can't be remedied within hours. We've turned off exchanges. We won't talk about that here. There's just no benefit.
Not us, though, right?
No.
I would have known that.
So I think that as a buyer, if I'm representing my clients who are the agencies and the advertisers, we went out there and just said, okay, you know what, we're going to lay it out and we're going to be really, really clear. And if you do not uphold these things, you get paused, terminated, you owe the client a make good.
Yep. And the space has evolved a lot over the last couple of years. I think when we first launched the exchange in 2011 on the video side, everything we did was a manual approach, meaning we had people looking at this stuff and on our side and vetting the publishers and so forth. We launched a partnership with Wide Ops about a year and a half ago at this point, where we're having somebody pre-filter and check mm-hmm. these impressions come across so that we don't deliver any invalid or fraudulent impressions to our buying partners. What have you guys done from that's different and unique in your approach to IQ? I know you've made some changes of late, and what are you guys doing now that's different in the last 6 months than it was in the previous 6 years?
Well, a couple things. So if you think about how most DSPs are set up, well, I'll at least talk about Turn. We have what we call a market. So an agency or an advertiser licenses a market. It's theirs. They have some customization that they can do there. So, like I said, back in the day, we had people that had to read through everything, and they did block lists, and it sucked. It sucked for everybody. Trust me, those poor people hated their jobs. Then we started having pre-filtering tools and post-ad serve tools. Those could be set up by a market, so you could choose any of the vendors, and we have about four vendors in there, and that gives the owner of that market, that agency or advertiser, the control, and they can run their post-ad serve tags as well, obviously. But what we realized was it represents Turn's brand if there are still issues. So even if our customer who does have the controls in place of their market, either someone four rows down who is the trader accidentally didn't put the filtering in for fraud filtering, that caused issues, or they didn't place the tags correctly, we just kind of said, you know what? We're going to take our own stance and we're going to block it all. In fact, I believe we said, we don't even want these fraudsters to make a penny. I don't want my ad serving systems to have to review the inventory. So we went at it with a pre-bid, still looking for someone to name that better than we have, if you're any smart marketing people. But what we're doing is we're leveraging Double Verify, and they've worked with us for about 4 months, so that we ingest everything on site and bot fraud, and it blocks it before it even comes into our system, so our customers don't even see it. Our servers don't even have to review the inventory at all. And we're paying for that. So the one bummer I have to say in this is, you're paying somebody, I'm paying somebody, the client's probably paying somebody. I know that all of you inventory quality people don't love hearing this, but at some point that's gonna break. That just doesn't really make sense, that there are potentially three different vendors, if not more, being paid along this process. But what we've found is, it gives that comfort to our buyers. They can still leverage other systems for pre-bid and post-bid. That's all great. But it was like, I don't want these. The only way I believe we as an industry can start to stop the fraudsters from going after what we do, our livelihoods, all of us have to care about this. I don't know about you guys, but I got three colleges, I hope, at least two colleges. One may not make it to college. He's adorable and he's musically inclined. It's going to be great. So I feel like we need to cut off the money. So that's why we are kind of standing up, writing a huge check to license this. Our customers feel great about it, and we're seeing unbelievable results.
That is a good point, because we as an exchange are writing a check to one of these IQ vendors. You guys are writing a check. It kind of begs the question, who is most responsible for this? If you think about the people in the ecosystem, the DSP obviously has a big role, the exchange has a big role. As we think about the other players, the brand advertiser, it's themselves, the agency themselves, the publishers. At the end of the day, who do you think is responsible? I mean, everyone's responsible, but how does that responsibility break down by component?
I'm pretty black and white on this one. I feel like it is your responsibility. I do. I feel like it's the, in a programmatic advertising world, I do believe it's the exchange's responsibility. I believe that they should filter and clean up any inventory before it comes to me. Now, guess what? It's my responsibility to make sure that when I say I'm serving a Toyota ad, it comes from Toyota, that doesn't have malware in it, that when I say I'm serving to this player size, when I say the audio is going to be off, that I follow all of the rules. And I do believe there's a pretty clear line. There is also responsibility at the publisher side, so any publishers out there, right? I get it, you guys wanna buy traffic, and it's the end of the quarter, and that salesperson says they need more. Just, you should have rules and guidelines, if you do not, about where you do and don't buy traffic. You have some responsibility here. I know what your desire is, to drive advertising revenue and bring more people to your site, and that's how you're measured. But we also know that sometimes some tactics that are done create more fraud.
Right. And what about the tactics on the advertiser side? I mean, we've seen advertisers that go both ends of the spectrum. Some advertisers are in the zero tolerance phase and they won't allow for anything. And then other advertisers, particularly on the video side, are trying to get $5 large player size pre-roll inventory. So how do you set the expectations for the advertiser to help them help us create a, you know, a fraud-free ecosystem?
Well, I mean, an analogy could be, if somebody tells me it's a one-year used Audi, it's an amazing condition, it's perfect, but it's only $6,000, I'm probably going to wonder if that's true. So if you're an advertiser, you have responsibility to understand, if you want zero fraud, then you can't get a $5 pre-roll in view. That doesn't exist. So I believe the advertiser should be thinking holistically about what DSPs they use. Did you notice that Turn has a really phenomenal fraud solution, just in case you're wondering? What DSPs you use, how your agency thinks about fraud, how they're monitoring it on your behalf, what tools they have. But I also think the advertiser should be really clear about what is their end goal. If their end goal is a quality consumer that will convert and is interested in their products, then they shouldn't just go straight after price. They should think about their attribution and the end result of the experience, and the page in where you run your ads matters. It really matters. So I would say I've heard kind of extreme requirements on the advertiser side for price, that price is the only thing that matters. And I think those two things are in conflict.
Right. And Some of the metrics that the advertisers are using are, we would call, old metrics. If the advertiser is focused on click or, you know, only focused on impressions, that yields perhaps the result that they don't want because
right.
they're gravitating to a metric that the fraudsters also know. And have you seen any introduction or use of other metrics that can help these advertisers sort of get the right inventory, get the high quality inventory?
Well, I mean, there's so many wonderful things now that we can do, right? You can, if you're an entertainment company, you really just care that someone has watched the movie trailer. You'd be stoked if they went and bought a ticket, but you have very strong metrics. We have a lot of CPG or retail clients, and you can actually measure on the cost of the value of that consumer. Did they go and purchase? You can do closed loop studies. So we are seeing people migrate towards more holistic attribution models. They are thinking about the customer decision journey. They're thinking about what stage they're in. And since they can break out their tactics, if they're going after new brand messaging and introducing a new product, their metric isn't a sale, right? They are thinking a ton about the context of the page, the quality of the publisher, the placement, how long they viewed that video. So they are really, really thinking about it all the way down to closer to the purchase funnel. Of course, they want to sell things. That's why people buy ads, right? But we are seeing them get a lot smarter. If you do that and you're very, very clear with your agency on what you're trying to accomplish, hopefully that agency or your DSP is coming back to you and giving you guidance on pricing. So one of the things I think that we did along with our fraud protection is everything is filtered all the way into our forecaster. So if you want to run high viewability with contextual targeting, you really want to make sure that you're either blocking certain types of content or you're focused on a very specific content. Oh, and by the way, you also want to target a set of consumers that have visited your page before. Our forecaster completely helps you understand how much that's going to cost you and how many impressions are really available before you've spent a penny. And I think that's also really important, is giving the tools over to the advertiser to understand what that price point is going to be. How many times might you be able to see that user, and how much of your total budget can you spend?
Right. So you talk about how many times you're going to see that user. That sort of brings us to the new mobile world, where more and more of these impressions are happening in a mobile world. The technology in mobile is not as evolved as it is on the desktop. So can you talk a little bit about the things that Turn is doing in the mobile world, both display and video, and how you're approaching this new, more tricky problem in a lot of ways?
So, well, first thing is, you know, we still have, I would say technology vendors are still working on this problem. Y'all know who you are. Mobile is not 100% solved by a third-party fraud vendor. But what we do see is we leverage some technologies that are out there. I think they're working okay. What I would say is targeting based on viewability is very important, but it's also very difficult to do on mobile.
Right.
It's very, very, very difficult.
Yeah, like how do you score viewability in a mobile app environment when it should be on the page?
It should be on the page, and if it's a tiny little screen, you know, so it's kind of like most of it's viewable. But the other thing that I would say is I think we're going to start to see the mobile exchanges and exchanges start to pass us more data. The one beauty of mobile is they pass a ton more information to us as a buyer and as a bidder in the ad call. So I'm hoping that we're going to see some of those signals. We also do a lot of I'm now spacing on the framing of it. Oh, but when you're actually targeting a specific user, so we have a lot of customers who are doing audience-based buying, we see that lowers the fraud rate because they are a known user. And since we are leveraging technology to block the bots mm-hmm. and block and make sure it's an actual person, we see that mitigates a lot of the risk there as well.
Yep. Yeah, so this is definitely an in-process thing. We do a lot of in-house evaluation of the mobile traffic and like looking at some of the tools that we used in web in, you know, 4 years ago we're using on the mobile side as the vendors catch up and have something that, I mean, you really need an SDK in the app world. You need an SDK on the app to be able to do some of the same things that we do today in web.
So what do you, I mean, I'll turn it on you because I already made it really clear who's responsible for this.
Exchanges, yes, we know.
This guy. So, let me, I know I'm not supposed to be asking you questions, I guess, but so what are you doing? Because I would say we've hit the tipping point where we're spending more on mobile devices, right?
Right.
And especially in video, and that is the fastest growing area. So tell me a little bit, and I should know this, but what are some of the things that you guys are doing?
Right, so on the web side, as I said, we partnered with a company, Wide Ops, which we did an evaluation of all the vendors, and we'll talk about the number of vendors in the space in a minute, because I think that's an important point as well. On the desktop video side, we partnered with a company, Wide Ops, where we do a lot of pre-bid analysis and make sure that we don't expose you to a potential request from a publisher that we deem to be, or a third party deems to be fraudulent. But that's not an all-in-one solution. You have to have your own internal evaluation team on the staff, reviewing this constantly, vetting the publishers as they get brought to the platform. On the mobile side, we're much more on that framework in terms of vetting the things up front and then monitoring it downstream to see, are there behaviors on the mobile app that we would see that we've seen in the previous desktop wars from years ago that we would use to inform how we block mobile apps or other things on the mobile world. So we're doing a lot of that today as we continue to help the IQ vendors get up to speed and think about an implementation in mobile that's going to work and be scalable. A lot of these vendors come with an SDK or some solution that requires them to propagate it out to all of the different apps out there. And we all know how long that takes because you've got to get it in the SDK, the app has got to download it, and then you've got to get all the users to then take that new version of the app, and that takes time. So we're trying to work with them to come up with a solution that we think is scalable and that can hit, because mobile is today, at least on the video side, is probably 30-35% of the inventory we see in video. And in display is probably 25-30% of the inventory as well. So it's a big and growing percentage. And so that's kind of where most of the new development is going in that place right now. So when you think about the vendors, you guys are working with DoubleVerify, we're working with WideOps. There's a lot of vendors in this space. When a company calls you and says, hey, I'm working with IAS, I'm working with one of these other vendors, how do you guys approach that? And what do you think is the right number in this space?
Mm-hmm. I'll save the second question for a second. So we do have a lot of vendors. We did a huge rigorous process. So Turn buys globally and we have such massive scale, it was difficult for us to find a vendor at the time who could do everything that we wanted, right? We wanted it to be blocked before it ever came in for bid. We wanted full access to reporting. We wanted a partner who was gonna build alerting systems within Turn. We wanted them to go with us if and when we had an exchange issue. And so we're really, really happy with DoubleVerify. And we will continue to test other companies, right? Like I said, I'm not 100% sold on the solutions that there are for mobile today, so we'll continue to test. If a client, and by the way, we love IAS, they're a huge partner of ours, and you can still leverage their technology in a pre-bid fashion. You can turn on a filter and run a campaign. You can also obviously run their post-bid analysis. If they leverage another vendor, that's completely up to them. But what I also want us to do is be slightly realistic, right? I want to make sure that we're not overanalyzing every single solitary impression to the point that we're screeching to a halt, right? If a client is using another vendor and they can send over the information, luckily this, you know, knock on, where's real wood here?
Down there.
Luckily this doesn't happen very often, but if they do come in, we want to investigate. And we have in our agreement, but not doesn't really matter that it's in a contract, a piece of paper somewhere, we have in our relationship with DoubleVerify that they would work with us. How many vendors should there be in this space?
How much should be spent on fraud generally?
I can't even tell you how much money we have spent.
Yeah.
Right?
For every $100 that an advertiser spends, what should be their expectation on how much of that is going to prevent fraud?
Again, if you go back to a black and white world where it's all rational, to me, it should all be absorbed by the exchange or publisher, ensuring that what they're offering, their product they're bringing to market, is of quality and is transparent in what they've said it is. So that advertiser, if they spend $15, they should get all of that $15 of value back, right? And they should be able to buy that. It shouldn't be a cut. So we're eating it. Turn's eating it. Doesn't make me happy. Our new CEO was really stoked when I showed him the cost of it, right? But hey, we're gonna pay for it because at this date and time with the client base that we have, we're just not gonna stand for it. And that was the only way I could think of to stop the money flowing into the fraudulent companies. So I hope that at a certain point in time, the advertiser again is responsible for their ads not having malware, for landing on a quality page, for being transparent about what they are doing with the video player. And I believe it should be the exchange and inventory side's responsibility to make sure that what they send to us is an actual person and a non-fraudulent site.
It's a good aspirational goal. All right, well, thank you guys for your time. Thank you, Maureen.